out of something. Well, I hope everybody's still awake. The really long process of us telling our stories, but they're very emotional. But my name is Jonathan Martinez. I'm from Warner Robins, Georgia. And just like my team, I am undocumented. I got to this country at the age of 4 with my mother, my dad, my brother, and my sister. We came on a visa that expired 6 months after we arrived here in the States. And I grew up, you know, just believing I had every opportunity just like everybody else. And it wasn't until my senior year in high school that I really understood what it was to be undocumented. At the age of 17, all of my friends wanted to go to college, and I actually had the ambition to join the military. I set up a meeting with a recruiter, and I was pretty much, I had taken the ASVAB. I was ready to basically just start a career with the Coast Guard. I wanted to be a search and rescue diver. And I remember opening the door, you know, full of adrenaline and excitement, ready to start what I thought was the rest of my life. I sat down, you know, he's smiling back, and we're just having a good conversation. And then, you know, we started getting to the questions of me giving him my documentation that I had. As he started, you know, putting stuff in the computer, that smile that he had and the joking that he had just immediately turned into like a look of confusion and just a seriousness. And you know, I still was like full of adrenaline, excited, and trying to figure out, you know, what I was going to do. And then he was just like, my first name is Jose. He's like, Jose, he's like, you're an illegal. You actually cannot join the military in the Coast Guard. You can't join any military branch. And I remember like asking him, like, you know, like, check it again. Are you serious? Like, what's going on? I was like, I've been here since I was 4. These are the papers that I have. You know, he did what he could. He called several other recruiter officers just to see if there was a way. But after 9/11, everything got really strict. They don't allow anybody who doesn't have documentation to enter and then gain their citizenship status at all or anything like that. So I left that office, and I pretty much, you know, like, whatever other person, and it all goes back to like mental health and how we have mental issues with being undocumented, especially graduating from high school and having your dreams ended right then and there. So I sat with my graduating class, you know, watching him walk across the stage. Everybody's talking about going to college, and one of my really good friends actually, you know, joined the Coast Guard, and he was doing the area that I wanted to do. So I didn't tell anybody that I was undocumented. I continued to keep it in the shadows. I kept it to myself, the only people that knew were my family. I graduated, and I remember that summer I just stood in my house, and I was like, I'm not going to do anything for the rest of my life. Like, there's nothing I can do. But the ambition that my family had to continue to push me and the faith that I had in God, I had to find something to do with my life. And Georgia being a very conservative state, also very, very Republican. They don't support immigration at all. And I was blessed with the opportunity to attend a 4-year university. I was able to get into a local community college, a 4-year college, and I graduated with a bachelor's in business administration and information technology. You know, I was very active with the community, getting involved, but I continued to remain in the shadows. Nobody knew that I was undocumented. I worked 3 jobs to pay for my education, it was a struggle to get the piece of paper that I got that now I'm not able to implement my degree and contribute back to this country socially or economically. And you know, with Georgia being a conservative state that it is, they passed the House bill, the HB 87, which is the anti-immigration law, like the copycat Arizona, like you guys what they were trying to do here in Utah and Alabama, and they have secure communities tied in with it and everything. In my last semester in college, I was picked up through secure communities, and I was placed in deportation proceedings to be removed from this country. I spent 4 weeks in the immigration detention center, 4 hours away from where I live. I pretty much was separated from my family, my friends, the whole life that I knew. Again, I felt that same depression that I felt when I was graduating from high school. Didn't know what to do with my life. I pretty much had given up when I was in there. I was just like, you know, I wanted to sign my papers off and just send me back. I don't want to be in this place anymore. The inhumanity things that go in immigration detention centers are just not spoken of how people are treated in there, how basically you have no communication with your family. Visitation, people cannot go and visit you because I know my family, I encouraged my mom, my dad, my brother, and my sister not to come see me because of the fact that they're undocumented and they could easily be picked up right there and be placed in the process of being deported. So I was actually screwed over by an attorney, immigration attorney. I never spoke with him. My dad hired him from the outside. He signed me up for a voluntary departure without my consent. They released me on a bond to attend my college graduation. One day before my graduation ceremony, I was released, paying $7,500 that my family, I don't know exactly the things that they had to go through to get that money to bail me out. And it's the process that I'm currently still facing. I'm still in the process of being deported. My case was closed because I was ordered voluntary departure. I was supposed to leave July the 4th of last year. Ironically, I was released on Cinco de Mayo and told to leave the country by July the 4th. So it was ridiculous. But in that detention center, I came in contact with a guy. He was also a dreamer. He was in there for 2 months. He'd given up hope on his entire life. His family didn't have money to get an attorney, so he had actually signed voluntary departure to be sent back. And after talking to him, me talking to my parents, I was like, maybe there's a way, for you to help out. I've heard of some free attorneys through the Catholic Services. So I gave him the number, and I was like, let's just try to do something. I requested a form to help him, cancel his voluntary departure. We submitted that in the morning. At nighttime, they have a dorm room about the size of this area in here. They fit about 55 to 65 people in this room in metal bunk beds with just, it's just, I don't even want to talk about it. It's not comfortable at all. But anyways, I was asleep. He was 2 bunks next to me, and about 2:33 in the morning, three officers run in the room. They start, yelling his name and checking everybody's badges, trying to look for him. So finally, when they found him, they told him that they were like, pack your things, you gotta go. Your bus is here, you're getting shipped. And as soon as I heard that, I jumped off the bunk, I walked up to him, and I'm like, you can't do that. There's a process for this. We have already filled out, to cancel his voluntary departure. And I actually had court 2 days after that, and the officer's like, if you don't go back to your bed, you're gonna be taken to isolated confinement where they lock you up for a week. And I was gonna miss court if I did that, so of course I pretty much stood back. I went back to my bunk. By this time, everybody in the dorm room woke up. Everybody started arguing with the officers, trying to get this kid to stay. I remember looking into his eyes, and he was just pretty much like, help me. Like he didn't really know what to do, and I didn't know how to help him. So I pretty much watched him be carried out of that room. He did pack his stuff. They literally have your stuff in bins on the bottom of the bed, and the officers threw his stuff in bags and then just like carried him out. And his name is Eduardo. I don't know his last name. I know he was deported to Mexico, but I have not had contact with him. I looked him up on Facebook and everything, but I haven't been able to find him. And I thought to myself once I was released, what am I doing hiding in the shadows? My employer, my colleagues, my friends, my best friend for 8 years doesn't know I'm undocumented. Every time they say, let's go on a cruise, I'm like, oh no, I gotta work. But really, it's because if I leave the country, I can't get back in. So I actually heard about a Coming Out of the Shadows rally that Nico was actually a part of in downtown Atlanta. And I've never been to one, and I was trying to get involved, so I actually went there and I saw 18, 17-year-old high school kids standing in front of the legislator's office and saying, I'm undocumented, I'm afraid, and then getting arrested for the fact that they are undocumented in the middle of the street because they want to stand up for the fact that Georgia put a ban on the 5 prestigious universities from allowing undocumented students to enter, and they wanted to ban all community colleges and state universities from allowing undocumented students to enter. So they were standing up for what they believed in, and I saw them, and I'm like, you know, what am I doing? Like, I'm 25 years old, I have a degree, nobody knows I'm undocumented, and everything that I've ever done for this community, everybody thinks I'm a U.S. citizen. I'm doing it because this is my country. And in reality, I feel that being an American is not a piece of paper. It's how you feel, how you live, how you believe, how you interact with your communities. That's what defines the American dream to me. And since that day, I became open about my status. I told everybody in my community, and I thought I was in a community where others were not undocumented. I mean, others that were undocumented were not open about their status either. So I felt that connection. I had people reach out to me and say, hey, I'm undocumented too. How did you get into school? How are you able to continue your education? Like, what are you doing to advocate for this? How can I get involved? And that's when I started feeling the need to advocate for this, not for myself or for the process that I was going in, the process of being deported, but for the people out there who felt that they don't have a voice and who also felt scared and isolated in a community that they call their home. So I heard about this campaign through Facebook, and I immediately contacted them. I felt the ambition to join it, and here I am today, walking nearly 3,000 miles, 13 different states, and I'm walking for the 2.1 million undocumented youth in this country that feel like they don't have a voice, and the 65,000 that continue to graduate from our high schools every year with that loss of hope from joining the military or going to college and reaching their dreams. So that's pretty much a little bit about myself. I know it's been a long session of listening to us, and if you guys have any questions or anything about the campaign, you want to see our blisters or pee or... if you guys have any questions, you know, feel free to ask them. There's, I think, a little bit of pizza left back there.
Sandals.
I wore sandals. I'm tired of wearing tennis shoes. I'm sorry. we are the campaign for the American Dream. And one thing that they didn't mention, I know some of you guys know about this, but our RV actually broke down. The RV is our safety vehicle. When we walk every day, the RV is where we sleep at nighttime when we don't have a place to sleep, when we don't have a contact in that community to allow us to rest for the evening or shower or whatever it may be. That RV broke down in Battle Mountain, Nevada, about 303 miles away from here, and the engine is shot on it. So we paid $3,000 for it. It's costing us about $5,000 to fix it, so it's not a wise investment for us. To try to replace it, because then again it may break down. So we're looking for another RV, and we do have a couple of events Saturday. I'm going to hand the mic over to Alex, and he's arranging it for us.
Yeah,